mental keyboard for myself.
Oh, yeah?
So I was like, I have this other USB keyboard.
And you're like, I'm going to do something to fix this.
But yeah, I'm excited.
Oh, man. I got all misty-eyed explaining to Mom and Dad about how much free space we're going to unlock in this room by reconfiguring everything.
Yeah, I think that'll be... We can figure out a time to do that in the next 2 weeks or so.
Yeah.
It'll just be a one-day thing.
Oh, shoot! I wanted to ask if you would be interested, and I'll throw you extra cash for it, but okay. I've got a... you're already listed as my companion pass holder
right.
on Southwest Airlines.
Yes.
And I actually have a good old-fashioned college show on the 13th.
I saw that you put that down.
Yeah, and so I haven't added you to the flight yet, but if not, I'll either have to spend points to take Brant...
Right.
And then also pay him, or I could pay you extra, and you could have a one-day adventure. It's not that hard a gig,
okay.
And you know, it's my other option is going by myself, and it takes me like 2 extra hours to set everything up myself. But
no, yeah, I can do that.
Cool. If you're up for a one,
that's like a Friday Saturday thing.
No, it's a Wednesday. It's a Wednesday overnight. So we'll do
Scan School isn't that, but I can have that done.
No. Yeah, correct. Yeah. You would want to have that figured out before.
All right.
Oh, yeah.
How's everybody?
Dude, I'm so stoked. I mean, I'm on such a positive vibe right now.
Why?
Because it's finally... Do you know why? Because the freaking world has woken up from a slumber and is finally getting back to work, which means I don't have to sit around and wait on the world to get anything done.
Oh, my God. You have no... idea how much this like I am living that emotion. Like I am so like the last 2 weeks have been me like, oh, I should really email.
I know, it's like, why? It's like, hey, have you heard back from the there's yet another holiday and another weekend and another reason. Like,
all right, don't worry guys, we're done with the holiday. Get ready for the weekend.
Yeah, it definitely it was grating. It was difficult. I had to time travel by just playing Hearthstone all day.
All right. There. All right. Let's. Can we do an audio check on everybody?
Heck yeah, we could do an audio check. You want to know how I'm gonna talk? I'm gonna talk like this. All the time. It's the only way I'm going to talk. Except for when I talk like this.
Okay. Andrew?
Hi, this is Andrew. I'm going to talk like this, except when I'm wiping my eyes because they're just itchy. Cool. And that's all I got.
Are you under the weather? You have some hay fever action?
Yeah, it's just the allergies. It's just Florida. I'm just allergic to Florida.
Justin?
Hey, your old pal Justin Young here, getting ready for another episode of Weird Thing.
Great. Thanks, guys.
Oh, hey, let me tweet out that this is happening.
Yeah, get a little tweet.
So, those hens that my parents have? Turns out some aren't hens.
Ooh.
Some of them are
axe
banging anything that moves.
Ew, Jimmy Cox.
Where's that coming?
A lovely ceremony, I assume for Mr. Montgomery and the new Mrs. Montgomery.
Yes, it worked out really well. It was really nice. It was good to see a couple buddies from high school who I hadn't hung out for years. Including a friend of mine, Chuck Yeh, who Chuck's neat guy. And then Christmas break, sophomore year, I get a call from my buddy Ken. He's like, Chuck's being sent to military academy.
Like, Jesus.
What? His dad just said, you know, had enough and said, all right, off you go, and shipped him off to military school. And then, you know, like he just got renditioned in the middle of nowhere. And Chuck went to military school, then was up in Georgia, ended up going to the Citadel. Chuck turned out great, but he, like, in college he had a, you know, then we hear like, Chuck's got a kid, yeah, he has a kid coming, you know, and like he was the first of us to have a kid. And so now his son is about to graduate the Citadel this year.
Oh my God.
you know, and, you know, he's got a son and a daughter about to graduate high school. The kids are just great kids, you know, and just, you know, it's just such a weird thing to hang out with, like, fully grown up, you know, descendants of a friend.
Really puts it into perspective, huh?
Yeah. My parents came and all that, so it was cool. And nice. So it was nice. It was a good time. Good time.
It was in Clearwater?
It was in St. Pete Beach.
Oh, nice.
All right, guys, I'm ready on my end whenever you are.
Heck yeah.
All right.
Well, I'll count you in. Let's go. In 5, 4, 3, 2.
Welcome to the Weird Things Podcast. I'm Andrew Main, joined by Justin Robert Young.
Hey, friends, it's me again.
And Brian Brushwood.
Oh, yes, yes, y'all.
So, gentlemen, there was a interesting discovery this year, which was what we believe may be an ancient hominid called Homo naledi, which is the naledi, N-A-L-E-D-I, pronounce it as you wish, where they found this inside of a cave in South Africa. We talked about this before, this very narrow passage. It was called Superman's Crawl, where you had to put one arm in front of the other, and it was this very precarious way to get in there. At the bottom of it, they found a bunch of fossils that looked deliberately placed, and the fossils don't quite match up precisely with anything else. They're still trying to figure out when they were placed there, why they were there, etc. But it was a fascinating discovery, and John Hawks, who has a really good blog about evolution and covering all sorts of ancient origins, who I followed for years, is one of the principal researchers on this. So it was kind of really cool to realize that, oh, this person I've been reading was secretly working on this. Anyhow, there was a bit of controversy that's just happened over this, and that they in the very lengthy report, they had something like 1,500 total specimens or 1,500 bones that they found that they've been going through and cataloging, and it was a really interesting archaeological excavation because they had a team of just it ended up being a team of female climbers who were able to go down in there and find it, not because they selected for that, but just because the people who offered, who had the skill set to do it, that's how it turned out. So it was this really kind of cool group of young people going in there and doing it, a very interesting discovery. And they're still trying to make sense of this stuff. They've been hesitant to date any of it. And then all of a sudden, we get a little controversy.
What could be controversial? This isn't some kind of creationist thing, right? They're not claiming
it's like science at its finest. We're understanding our natural world and the descendants that brought us here.
Well, now what happened is Michael Shermer, who we all know, Michael Shermer, Skeptic Magazine, Michael Shermer as a friend, I like Michael Shermer, has in a writer for Scientific America, has criticized, I would say kind of a little bit harshly, saying that, hey, did they just quickly discount the idea that they could have met a violent death? Because Shermer points out that so many ancient hominid species or hominid interactions, just that if you go into the further back, you go look at grave sites, the more likely you're going to find that they met some sort of violent death. And Shermer saying, hey, maybe this was murdered and this wasn't really, they didn't really address this and et cetera. And so was also sort of made a criticism about the journal they published it in, where he didn't go for, it wasn't a more mainstream journal, it was eLife, et cetera. So it was a kind of a critical attack almost of this. And yeah. John Hawks has such replied to this. He's like, hey, if you look into the report, you'll see that we looked at every single bone for any evidence of violence, of trauma, of tooth marks, or anything else like that. So we have ourselves a little science.
Well, okay, so I'm
a little science slap fight. Well, get in the ring, boys.
So, in which corner is which position? Walk me through this again.
So, Shermer's article, I should say, kind of criticizes the speed at which it was released and suggests that they overlooked or didn't really consider the idea that it could have been they were put there because they met some sort of violent end and were stashed there.
So you're saying like he's saying it could have been that there was a rock slide and the heads got dashed and
they were murdered. They were murdered
that they murdered each other because that is, I guess, prevalent enough that it should have been addressed more prominently in the write-up, right?
Correct.
Well, and what's the counter position?
The counter position is, hey, no, we actually looked at every single, if you read our full report, you'll see that we looked at all the bone fragments for any evidence of that kind of trauma, and we found none. And he's sort of saying, hey, back off. No, that was paragraph 45. Did you look?
Well, and so if not murder, then what is the default, the null hypothesis on this?
Well, it's just that they may have met some sort of natural end, and then they were deposited there. And Shermer's point, and it's one that we all agree with, is that we have this. There's a too idyllic view of how ancient peoples lived, is we ignore how often they met violent deaths, and sometimes they'll say, yeah, no, those deaths weren't actually fine. They didn't die from war. It was just one person in the village was on a revenge thing. It's like, well, if 50% of the bodies we dig up prior to 2,000 years ago, et cetera, whatever, met violent deaths, that means that you were more likely to die a violent end than today.
So when the initial report was published, what was the newsworthy angle of it? Because it is this a case where Michael Shermer just read the article and he's like, whoa, you're missing the juiciest part of this right here? And they're saying, no, it's not that juicy.
No, I think he's criticizing the science of it. You know, he's saying, and correct me if I'm wrong, Andrew, that like, you know, like, oh no, you missed this. Your write-up of this important find is incomplete because you didn't account for murder.
That would be the Shermer's point of view, and the rebuttal is, no, actually we did. We did look for these things that you said that we didn't.
So is this the case of Shermer maybe not reading things so well, or?
I don't know. I he's a thorough guy. I think it's certainly going to be interesting, and I sent this to my friends who know Michael and who know Hawks and all this, and it was the Bill Hader eating popcorn gif. Because like, these people are all far more brilliant than I am and know way more about the topic than I do, but it was a very interesting, because like, hey, here's this guy I really dig, John Hawks, who's doing really interesting research, and here's this other guy I really dig, Michael Shermer, who's just opened my mind about a lot of things, and all of a sudden this clash, you know, like, wow.
I guess I'm just surprised that it doesn't seem like a very clash-worthy thing to disagree about, where it's like, let's say that paragraph wasn't in there, and that he didn't account for it possibly being an assault. It doesn't seem like that's the kind of thing I would write. I don't want to call it a hit piece, but certainly like a confrontational article,
full port, right? Like, it's like your hashtag shots fired.
Well, yeah. I mean, it's like, I don't know that I would come out guns ablazing, just be like, did you consider this? Ex-murderer.
Shermer writes, instead of publishing in Science or Nature, the prestigious journals in which major new fossil human finds are typically announced, the authors unveiled their discovery in eLife, an open access online journal that fast tracks the peer review process. Instead of meticulously sorting through the 1,550 fossils belonging to at least 15 individuals for many years, as is common paleoanthropology, the analysis was published a mere year and a half after the discovery, November 2013 and March 2014. What triggered my skepticism, however, was the scientist's conjecture that the site represents an example of deliberate body disposal, which, as the media read between the lines, implies an intentional burial procedure. This, they concluded, was the likeliest explanation compared with four other hypotheses.
So this is a case where Michael Shermer feels like he's helping to build the dam to hold back the tide of bad scientific writing, and that good procedures would be to take longer, to be more thorough, and to release to more respected journals. Instead, he's seeing some slippage to a less respected journal, and an example of what he's catching is the fact that this wasn't addressed.
Well, the problem is that Hawks says, no, we did do this thorough. Hawks is saying, you wanted a year and a half, but we went through, we put a tremendous amount of that resource into this. He's like, read the paper, you know, read our paper at how detailed we went into the analysis of the fossils. You're tripping. He says, you're throwing out this hypothesis of violence. He says, and that's one that we addressed, and then one of the things we specifically looked for was that. And that's the criticism, like, is that this is, you know, again, I don't, you know, I don't have a hominid in this fight, but I see, I read the Shermer thing first. I'm like, well, this is an interesting sort of take. And I have not read the Hawks paper. I read his overview coverage of it. I've not read the detailed thing because partially I wouldn't understand it. But Hawks is, in his rebuttal to this, which is worth reading, is saying, hey, one, you're picking on us for choosing eLife, which is a very, he says, it's a respectable journal to do it. It's a newer one. It's one of these things that is very open access. And he says, two, is you have this criticism that we didn't do a thing, but there's the thing where we did the thing that you said we didn't do.
how much of this is about the journals?
Yeah.
Like, how much of this, it kind of just feels like this is on a blog and not a newspaper, and therefore I look at it scancy pants.
I think might be more, it might be more, there's another player, there's somebody else involved here.
A third man?
Oh, wait, so you're saying that somebody calls and you're like, this guy's doing a thing, he's cutting out my journal.
Eh. I might think that, not relating to the journal specifically, but more to, it might be that Shermer has contacts or knows people. My guess would be that, because he needs, some of the best presentations I've gotten on Anthropology have been things that he's put on, that were accessible to me. And I know that he's very in touch with that community. And it might very much be that there might be other people who are like, hey, yeah, no, we have some issues there. But he might be vocalizing that. Again, I'm putting words in his mouth. And again, Shermer is wonderful at encouraging debate and responding to these things. And that's what's going to make this interesting, is that, he will have a response. He's very good at giving other people an opportunity to hear this. So, I can't speak highly enough of him.
How much do you think this exact paper gets published in a different journal? Do you think that we would have seen this level of criticism?
Well, part of the thing is we can't.
Although I guess that's a chicken and egg thing, because he's right. Like, to publish it in the journal, you would have to have this level of rigor.
Correct.
Which, the absence for which is part of the reason why you're writing it.
Right. Right. But again, in a larger sense, though, this is kind of the debate that we see between Wikipedia and Encyclopedia Britannica, and I wonder how much. Universally, attitudes are changing as far as respectability, because, there was one study at one point that found that Encyclopedia Britannica had about as many errors as Wikipedia. But the difference was, when the study came out, Wikipedia fixed those errors within like 30 seconds, whereas Encyclopedia Britannica did not. And I don't know. Is it a place where, is it the madness of the crowds or the wisdom of the crowds to take advantage of a more open platform where people could fast track their ideas out to the world?
Some of these journals, and even some of the established ones, it's been shown how easy it is to often get things published and completely BS things. And I don't know that I would say that there have been a number of issues where I've questioned the credibility of Scientific America or Nature magazine when they get into a philosophical or some sort of political of view,
sure,
that they're not going to deviate from, and to hold them as being, hey, you should take it seriously. But the fact that, like, Science and Nature are the two ones that that you'd suggest, and not Scientific America, but Science and Nature, and they've committed some great sins in my view in some cases. But as far as this, I think that the picking on the source had to do more with his Shermer suggestion that this was just released too quickly.
Yeah.
But there's the alternate point of view is, it's fine to be quick if you put everything out there, and also if you voice whatever criticisms. And we criticized the NASA arsenic announcement, because that was something that, as soon as it came out there, within days, there were really credible criticisms of that. And it seemed like it may have been a case of cherry picking your referees or cherry picking the people you go to for counterpoints of view.
Mm-hmm.
And here, Shermer is critical of a point of view, of we are critical too, of this, hey, none of these people lived happy lives, it was great, and now we have this dissent where we know, objectively speaking, that humanity is more moral, you're less likely to die from violence than ever. But that's not an attitude. We're gonna get a speech on guns from our president, despite the fact that gun violence, gun homicides are declining, have been declining for decades, yet the perception is that we're at this critical mass. And that's frustrating, when you're like Shermer, a public speaker talking about these topics, and it's like, no, this is the way it is. And if you don't address that, then we're going to keep building this inaccurate picture of how the world works.
And, how they covered it back in hominid times.
Oh, yes. Man. Do you remember those reports? Because all of a sudden, in walks Ugdog, who's got like a bashed-in skull. And meanwhile, Glaktar is all like, he's grunting, like he knows for sure. And then Nancy Grack is all, she's pointing fingers left and right. And everybody's tuned in over here. Meanwhile, Sheriff Ugblug was you know, he hadn't even finished his forensic investigation yet. He was trying to match up, you know, he's grabbing rocks and holding it up to the hole in his head.
And you want to know what? It's all because of the almighty sand dollar or pepper.
That's right, man. It's like when it comes down to it, it's all about them seashells. Am I right? Them pretty baubles to give to the ladies.
Actually, when they would go ahead and throw to a commercial for patreon.com/weirdthings.
As old as murder, patreon.com. Yeah, man, support our show. Head on over to patreon.com/weirdthings. If you enjoy the show exactly 20 cents per episode, well, then we'd like to have 20 cents per episode. If you enjoy it a buck a show, well, then you're a better person than we thought you were, and we take back three things we said about you that one time. Just head on over, join the club, and know that you're making a difference. You're going to be keeping us regular. You're like the Metamucil to our podcasting bowel movements.
Your support is fibrous and well received. Thank you very much. Patreon.com/weirdthings.
This week via this was actually originally from May 31st, and it just popped up again, and it was Matt Novak on Paleo Future Gizmodo points to a article that goes into explaining how investors should be, a warning to airship investors from 1908.
Oh, fantastic. This is great. I mean, this, so we think we have space fever right now. We got, you know, space ventures getting ready to capture meteors and mine them, and we got self-landing rockets that are ready to fire off again the moment they land. We got the big space race. This has to be nothing compared to airship fever back at the turn of the 20th century.
Let me read you some of this. This is from the original editorial. So as far as the possibilities of freight transportation are concerned, it may be passed with a word. Wherever ordinary methods of transportation on land are available, it will be absurd to carry goods of any sort through the air. The cost of such transport would be measured not in mils per ton mile as in rail or carriage, but in cents per ton mile as in wagon haulage, but in dollars or hundreds of dollars per ton. It is true that for exploration in difficult country as over the Arctic ice or in rough mountain regions, there are possibilities in the airship, but such, of course, is rather scientific than commercial.
I mean, goes on. In his defense, we do measure air freight in dollars or hundreds of dollars. I mean, he's spot on in that regard.
But he 5 years later, we're using it for mail.
Right.
You know. I mean, yes. Yes, we now, you know, we
measure everything
currency
in dollars.
Yeah,
in dollars, right? But even within a decade when he said that, they were already saying, you know what, getting mail and other things back and forth faster.
I love this. I want this to be a new segment, just historical haters. Haters through.
Oh, my God. Yeah, what would be great is to read. That would be a fun game. Maybe we should do it on Night Attack sometime when we have Andrew on again. We could do a bit where you read the hysteria, leaving out what the subject is, and you have to place, what is it they're terrified of, and put it in the right historical context.
Now, in the same article, this is from Novak reporting. The article continues by laying out the impracticality of passenger air travel, seen as more of an amusement that might be useful at fairs rather than as a practical means of transportation. Interestingly, the author also calls out the high-speed automobile as a toy of the rich, which allows them to vent their surplus energies.
Dude.
And I've had on Twitter, I say something about Elon Musk. I'm like, yeah, we're just making cars for rich people. I'm like, well, this Model 3 is going to be $35,000. Like, well, that's the price of a Mercedes. I'm like, listen, if you think $35,000 is a rich person's vehicle, then I don't know what to tell you.
Dude, I'll tell you what this makes me think of is this quote. The children now love luxury. They have bad manners, contempt for authority. They show disrespect for elders, and they love chatter in place of exercise.
Oh, my God. I love that he went full get off my lawn. It's just it has to devolve even to, youth gone wild.
Do you guys have a guess as to who said it?
I mean, that was attributed, I think, to Socrates.
Yeah, so it is. But I believe it. I want to say
that's not from that.
No. This is, I do believe it's misattributed to Socrates, because when I saw it, I wanted to say it was like, not Cicero, one of them old, anyway, it's allegedly from, there we go, Snopes.com says Socrates, well, it says, it's pointed out in the Snopes forums that Socrates never wrote anything, so if anything, it would have been Plato quoting Socrates, but I believe, it came up somewhere else.
Quoteinvestigator.com.
Quoteinvestigator, well done.
Has determined that the author of the quote is not someone famous or ancient.
What?
Oh. It was crafted by a student, Kenneth John Freeman, in 1907.
Yeah, that's still old. Still counts. Still works.
Yes. So wait, is there anything else in this this airship hysteria?
So he discounts one, the idea of using it for passenger travel.
Okay.
For the carriage of passengers, the necessary risks attendant upon flight through the air, either with the dirigible balloon or the aeroplane, are certain to limit passenger traffic to the field of sport and amusement. This is, of course, a much more considerable field than is often realized. The public is willing to pay very high prices for mere amusement. And so he describes that, but explains that the experience of high-speed automobile has proved the existence of a very large leisure class of wealthy men who find vent for their surplus energies in undertaking all sorts of risky exploits. Flight through the air may very likely become popular as a fad for a few years hence as auto racing is today, but it'll have just as little relation to the serious, practical, everyday business of carrying freight and passengers for the great workday world as have the 100-horsepower automobiles that break the speed records in France and America. He's wrong on two things.
Okay, so here's the thing. Like, we should have, like, a Luddite's guide to making predictions or polemics about what will and will never be done. It's like, make sure to qualify.
Wayne, and why it's no use for military applications either.
Yeah, right? Well, understand that in general, it's a bad idea to bet against human ingenuity for just about anything. And you should always, I'm going to say always, you should always avoid saying never in your thing, or it's like, it will not.
That's definitely a good point. I mean, really... He definitely misses wildly on not necessarily betting against ingenuity, right, but just that technology. He did not feel that airships, which to be as fair as we can to him, he seems to mean half as much, as much about dirigibles as he does airplanes, right? And dirigibles have not necessarily seen their day in our modern society.
That's correct. But I mean, just look, if you're going to say things that won't happen, put a time limit on it. That's a good idea. Say by 1916, I highly doubt.
Why don't you go ahead and read this? I'm sorry, man, I'm trying to cape up for you, but here we go. He just keeps putting his foot in his mouth so many years ago.
You want Andrew to read this part here?
Yeah, Andrew, were you going to read the military stuff?
It is said that leading military nations are vying with each other at the present time in the development of military airships, but this has not proved that these structures can be made practically useful in the serious business of actual warfare. Of all the apparatus ever proposed for use on the battlefield, a flying machine is beyond all question the most vulnerable. It offers an ideal mark to the bullets of the enemy. Its limitations of weight forbid its protection by any sort of armor. Had the flying machine been developed 40 or 50 years ago when projectiles were limited to small velocities and short ranges, it might have performed some service in observing the enemy's forces, but with modern infantry rifles discharging projectiles with initial velocity of 2,700 feet per second and with light artillery fitted to the discharge of perfect hailstorm of bullets having equal velocity and range, the rise of an airship at any point within several miles of a hostile army would be merely the signal for its immediate destruction.
Well, good thing air combat never went anywhere.
Yeah, it's no such thing as air superiority, apparently.
Wow. Yeah, that one, we got it wrong. Great moments in history.
And it's just, for something around 1908, that within less than 10 years, how quickly that became not correct. And then by the time we get to the Second World War, how decisive air power was in much of the campaign and how that's just totally changed the frontiers of warfare, was just aerial bombing. And even then, dirigibles actually played a part to an part of it. So this was the next year the official Wright brothers were testing a military airplane.
Wow. That is amazing.
That's amazing. That's great.
But to the defense of this guy, looking at this thing, you're like, well, that's, yeah, that's not going to be very practical, you know, and that's the problem, is that we project the future as just a larger version of the present.
Well, and that's the thing, is it's not what we know, it's what we don't know and can't mm-hmm. possibly predict, right? When you are up against the human ingenuity of not just one person, but the rest of the world versus, you know, you look at what's available now and you're like, I can't picture this possibly being of military value. Therefore, I feel safe in proclaiming that it can't possibly happen. But you're pitting yourself against all of the military inventors for the next however many years, trying to come up with ideas that you never would have thought of. And in that regard, it's a safer place to assume that there's no way for you to outwit them.
Let me ask you guys a question. Is in reading this guy and kind of laughing at him to an extent, what have we been critical of? And I'm trying to think, what have I been downplaying? What have I been critical of that might be, oh, yeah, later on, like, well, Andrew, remember when you made fun of this? Certainly space elevator.
Space, God darn it.
Yeah, but I mean, I went from a fan of that to, wait, if we have reusables, then that's that. When space elevator seemed like the only game in town, then that was, wow, well, that's the thing. And now that we really suspect that it's not, and I haven't thrown out like a space elevator maybe a several hundred years from now kind of thing, when our materials technology is such to the point that we're not worried about the catastrophic failure problems or whatever, but I'll defend that and say there's just so many other
that seems like an Amazon thing, like after UPS and FedEx have, you know, monopolized you know, reusable rockets, Amazon's like, you know, we could save five quatloos on a shipment of a bleep blop, and if we just built a railway to space and profits.
Yeah, I guess for me the reason that parties I'm so dismissive of it is that it's a geoengineering project that has no parallel that's ever existed, that would require a level of cooperation and everything else that's to me is just as limiting as, it's not just, if we have this thread that's strong, it's like, that's the easy part to me. It's
right. Well, it's what to do when the thing collapses and whips itself around, breaking the sound barrier as the kinetic motion of orbit slams into it.
The sign on to doing this, but anyhow, but that certainly space elevator is something that space tourism. I think space tourism would be like a $1 billion thing. I think it'll be an enterprise,
but that's
not
nothing compared to resource harvesting.
It's to me like that's the putting. We can get into resource harvesting in a second, but to me, the space tourism thing is kind of what he's talking about, like putting airplanes at carnivals and stuff. It's like, well, yeah, but that's not the real enterprise.
We have been very critical, and I mean we as in Andrew and I and not Brian, on one-way trips to Mars. We were very critical on the idea that that you would have one person go, you know, not necessarily like... settlement, right? Like not like putting the whole thing there, but like the first early explorers, like we were very critical that would not be seen as inspiring. Do you think that we'll eat those words?
Are you asking me or Andrew?
I don't know. I mean, I'm just bringing it up.
I don't think that anybody capable of doing a serious mission to Mars is going to do it as a one way. And so we will never get to know if we were wrong on that.
I disagree. Okay, so Elon Musk is what, mid-40s? So I'm picture 20 years from now. He now has revolutionized. And by the way, if we're talking about times we eat crow, I definitely have to eat crow over the superiority of reusable rockets over the long-term, highly unlikely, you know, in my lifetime, space elevator solution. I mean, you guys... in every way, you know, ran the numbers in a way that they were just in my position became indefensible. And I am definitely on team reusable rockets. But let's say 20 years from now, Elon Musk now has a fleet of, say, 100 to 500 rockets that are all reusable. And all of a sudden, the cost of getting something to orbit is about $1 a pound, maybe we'll call it, you know,
15. I mean, I don't know how we get to a buck, but let's say 15.
Okay. 15 bucks per pound. He now has enough billions of dollars that he says, yeah, here's what'll happen is we're going to, I'm starting a flood of one ship per week for the rest of my lifetime. And I'm going to be, you know, I'm going to let, like, you know, a couple years of them go. They're going to drop packages of all kinds of stuff. We've got some robots. They're going to start building fuel. We'll have, you know, escape things or whatever. And he's like, and then 5 years into it, I'm going to be on one of those journeys. So around the time I'm 65, 70 years old, I'm going to land on Mars and I'm going to die on Mars. And, you know, I'll be using prepackaged food during all that time. Hopefully while I'm there, I'll set up enough pop tents to invite other people to come join me, but this resource train is just going to flood, and I'm going to be the first pioneer of Mars, and I'm going to die there. I absolutely believe that in our lifetime that could totally happen.
Yeah, but that's a different, totally different proposition than what had been suggested, and it wasn't by you. It was something, but the originally was, let's just use our existing resources to save money and just do a one-way trip there and not have to worry about bringing the person back.
Okay, so picture this, same scenario, but let's say a little bit earlier, let's say same scenario or same intent, but let's say Elon Musk says still has the same fleet, same cost to go there. He says, I was just diagnosed with an inoperable brain tumor. I'm going to die in 4 years. I would like to spend those 4 years on Mars. So I'm going to go to Mars and die and be the first person to die on Mars. Like, I could see that.
My kids, I'm going to live on Mars and die there.
I could totally see that too. Or if not him, then some, you know, well-respected scientist or whatever.
Yeah, I understand. I guess for part of me, for me, is when Elon Musk is one of the first people to tear apart the one-way trip plan, because he's pointing out that, you know, the DNA of Elon Musk is, no, let's figure out what if you can do this thing and then do this other thing that people thought was impossible, then you can actually do it, then you can go this way. And, like, yeah, I absolutely can see that if somebody had the means to do it, you know, and said, hey, I'm going to die, that's fine. But again, to me, that's a different proposition than, hey, let's just send somebody there one way, half-assed, without a return ticket to show that it could be done. For me personally, I go, man, what? Let's really put our brain power to do it and figure out how to bring you back, because then that's really inspiring.
I guess that is the biggest thing. And that's the only thing about this idea that I always keep getting hung up on, is that if we're at the point where somebody wants to go to Mars and spend a significant amount of time there, even at the risk that they might not come back, like, how far off are we in that world from being able to bring them back, or B, like, colonizing? Like, you know, because even in your scenario, like the resource train, he's looking at, like, hey, look, I'm just the first dude, you know, I'm just Brigham Young saying this is the spot, and I want everybody else that, you know, wants to colonize Mars to come to colonize Mars with me. It's not the, like, hey, we're just gonna, one dude's gonna go there and his death will be a,
yeah,
symbol.
I guess my whole opinion is that Mars is so difficult to get to. It's such a steep mountain to climb and get down to the other side that our appetite to go to Mars is greater than our scientific ability to go there and come back. And if I was gonna make a stake bet now, it's that whoever the first human being to land on Mars is, dies on Mars. I don't see any way. I don't see any. Now, whether he dies at a ripe old age after 30 years of being there as the first colonist, or whether it's a mishap happens and he doesn't make it back or whatever, it just seems like the odds are much, much higher of by the time we're ready to go. Because they're at the bottom of the well. We can, once we get reusable rockets going, we could fling resources down to them. But the amount of resources it would take to fling down at the bottom of the well so that they could come out of the well and come back to Earth.
No, remember, it's one-third gravity. It's we have the thing that landed a week ago would be able to take off from Mars.
Yes, and well, I guess if you built a spacecraft that looped around and you did similar,
you got to look at the rumored plans for the Mars Colonial Transport. It's all part of the plan. I mean, if we were trying to go to another Earth with Earth-like gravity, I would say, yeah, that's really going to be much more challenging. But because it's got one-third gravity, escape velocity is very different there than it is here. That you can build a single ship to orbit or escape velocity Mars rocket, that can be done. that's if it, but if it was an Earth to another Earth, I'm like, yeah, that's going to be, it's a hell of a more different proposition. But, you know, we went to the moon and came back with 1960s level technology because getting off the moon was a hell of a lot easier than getting off Earth.
Right.
Well, there we go. People doing whatever sensory podcast 50 to 100 years from now. Somebody's right. Somebody's wrong. You can all laugh it up, guys.
Please, agents. Please be like, look up.
And they didn't realize it was a simulation all along and just had to know the cheat code.
Yeah, I'm just going to put it out there. Please look up whatever artificial intelligence is meant to simulate my existing consciousness long after my desiccated corpse has evaporated into the wind, and tell that artificially intelligent entity that the person upon which he was based was correct.
Or wrong.
Or wrong.
So I know I've been skeptical about the arrival, the practicality arrival of autonomous cars. That I think that certainly we see them, they function. There was an article that came out that this hacker, hey, I came up with a car that's 99% as good as Google or Tesla's autonomous car. But I'm like, yeah, but that 1% is what is the difference between murder.
Yeah,
and something that we're happy with, and I certainly think that it's going to be that bigger challenge. It's a bigger challenge, and we just saw in California they passed legislature that says, hey, not only do you have to have a driver in a self-driving car, you're going to have a special license.
Do you feel like I don't mind the special licensing part? I think that is again not my favorite, but I don't think it's unreasonable. Do you think that they are significantly...
For that on top of a regular driver's license?
Yeah. Well, for example, you know, because there's special circumstances. And again, I'm not a fan of it. I would not wish for it, but...
It would be like getting a motorcycle.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, you should take a day-long course on things that you should know about your self-driving car that you don't need to know on a regular driving car. That seems reasonable to me. The requirement that you have to have a steering wheel and a brake and all those old-fashioned things just seems like it's really limiting development of this go-to auto-driving Uber thing that Google's trying to put together. That seems like you're really trying to limit the technology there.
Well, I guess I look at that and that special license is even more inhibiting because a big goal of this is we have a population that gets older. We have substantial number of handicapped people with vision problems who have to rely on other people. That you're now saying, "Oh no, this is even further removed from you. You're because you can't get a driver's license. You really can't ride in one of these self-driving cars."
Well, yeah. Okay. My guess is that more realistically, I mean, again, we're so adverse to automating jobs. I think we're going to have essentially Uber drivers that do even less than Uber drivers, you know, who pretty much sit and read all day in a thing and make crap money.
You're not getting the cost advantage of getting rid of that driver.
Correct. But I do believe we're looking at a fleet of, I think they're going to put up with that in the short term because what the world needs to see is a few years of the dramatic proof that robots are better drivers than people. And I think once they see it real quick, they're going to release or relax the legislative hiccups on there.
I hope that's the case, but I've been in a skeptical position as far as how legislation's going to handle this and was not edified to find out that California just decided to double down on my pessimism.
But if anyone's going to, you know, jump the gun on the hand-wringing and come up with preemptive legislation, I mean, you know, Texas is going to wait until after they're covering the roads before they finally announce, yeah, no, this is fine.
Mm-hmm. Well, this also kind of seems like, you know, whenever anybody kind of gets into disrupting transportation, there seems to always be kind of laws that cover up for it, right? Or react to it. And we saw it with Uber, and I don't think that, you know, self-driving cars, the idea of eliminating drivers will be anything different, you know? Like that's just, we're going to have to deal with, you know, this kind of stuff, you know, this kind of legislation. I think that's, you know, I don't know what changes it though, because I don't think, Brian, that like it's necessarily people will that a switch will flip with people to say, oh, wait, this is safer. I think that convenience will always be the first thing that kind of makes people think that this is something that, you know, we need to now bend laws to accommodate. But I don't know when that happens, and I don't know when it becomes something that's like immediately like, oh, wow, that's super cool. I really like that. Like, is there a sliver? What is the inside lane for a self-driving car that makes people think like, oh, that's really cool? Like, is it just elder transport is saying like, hey, you know, we're going to have these lanes so elderly people can get around.
It could be a lot of things. Like, so I just drove this morning from St. Pete Beach to here. So it's about a 3.5-4 hour drive. And I would love to have spent that drive doing something other than driving. And if you broke down, if you had autonomous cars and you broke down the cost per mile or whatever, that becomes extremely competitive or efficient, and it becomes a different mode of transportation. And California is eager to spend trillions of dollars on a high-speed rail that won't connect anything that needs to be connected, that you'll still need cars to get to. It is a boondoggle. It's just watch the Simpsons episode. And I get in discussions with people like, oh, no, be like, yeah, you're it's not going to go as fast as you want, and it's really about landowners and people, construction projects. It's about a cash. It's getting more money out of the government for projects that don't do anything versus, man, you know, coming up with some really good, sensible, practical things for this. What could happen if we had an amazing autonomous car transportation infrastructure that's being paid for by private corporations competing with each other?
Yeah, no, you'll get no disagreement from me there, man.
Yeah, it'd be cool.
So another thing that you, 100 years from now, can judge us for. We are making bold predictions, and we want you to judge us.
Gosh, remember when they thought that moving faster than 20 miles an hour was a good idea? Didn't realize that it was adverse to your health and destroying the fabric of the space-time universe?
Exactly, yeah. That we're liquefying our organs by moving them at an unnatural rate of speed.
Picks?
Yeah, man. I got a pick. I'm reading a book, and maybe Bryce has hung around enough to tell me where I heard about it, but on one of the podcasts, or maybe it was an article I was reading, but somewhere it recommended Chasing the Scream about the beginning and end of the drug war, and it does a fantastic job of kind of explaining where the origins of Chasing the Scream is. It does a great job of explaining the difficulties, and it I'm two-thirds of the way through the book now, and it's going through some of the scientific evidence that suggests that not just humans but all animals seek the ability to alter their consciousness from time to time. The example they give is some mongooses
listening to the Doors.
They had a, there's one group of scientists that had a group of mongooses. They introduced a some drugged thing. I want to say it was like LSD or something that all the mongooses tried. They got dizzy, and then they avoided it. They avoided it like the plague for the next long time, until one of the mongooses died. The other mongoose, encountering the corpse, decided it wanted to get wrecked and not be here. At that moment, ran straight over and started taking the drugs. It's like, I got to get out of here. And the examples throughout the animal kingdom, from elephants eating fermented apples to toddlers spinning around and holding their breath to create a dizzy experience. It seems to be something universal. It's a fascinating book. Really, really interesting. Tells some harrowing tales of the collateral damage of the drug war. Very, very even-handed. I'm loving it. I'm loving it a lot, and I highly recommend it.
Excellent.
I got a pick here. It's the same. I think I picked this last week. I'm gonna pick it again because I liked it so much. I have all but the season finale of Fargo season 2 to watch.
Oh, sweet!
I have liked it a lot. There was specifically. Is it Nick Offerman?
Yeah, dude. Yeah. Nick Offerman is gold in this.
This is a moment, listeners to this show, for which Nick Offerman has this kind of star turn episode where his character really comes front and center. And I'd like to imagine that he plays, without spoiling, this isn't really a spoiler. He's a lawyer and he is drunk and he is called upon because he's the only lawyer in town to defend somebody, and a staggering lyrical Nick Offerman defending the rights, I imagine to be the just a like Brian he lives inside Brian's brain, like, you know, he is, it is the essence of every time Brian gets stopped at the TSA, like, I think the Nick Offerman you know, just going on and on about the jackbooted thugs and how we have rendered freedom from the English like blood from a stone, and now we it is up to us to protect it. You know, it's amazing. He's great. That episode specifically is one of my favorite just television episodes ever. It has everything that I love about it, and his character in that episode specifically is just great. Like, it just really showcases him as an actor. It's amazing, Fargo, like, that they are able to take everything you love about a Coen Brothers movie without the Coen Brothers and make it as good as it is. Like, it's almost, you know, I read one review of it that, like, it's kind of so good you sort of get dulled at how good it is, where it's like, oh, look at that perfectly framed shot. Like, oh, look at that amazing performance. Oh, look at that. Like, you kind of like, oh, I don't know if I'm connecting to these characters as much. Well, yeah, because it's an ensemble cast being used perfectly, where you're never really getting too much or too little of any of these amazing actors. It's great. I've loved it quite a bit, and I think everybody should watch it.
Dude, Mike Milligan. I could watch an entire series of just Mike Milligan doing Mike Milligan stuff.
And yeah, he's great, and I loved how they've I think on another show, he kind of would have become the Kramer, where you just, like, you're so fascinated by him that you want to stay on him.
Right.
The show has been at its benefit. Again, it's like you are always just getting the perfect amount of everybody.
What about you, Andrew?
I'm going to try to watch Fargo tonight. So shut up, everybody. All right, I get it.
Okay, so real quick, here's your question. Justin is doing the fascinating experiment of watching them out of order. He's starting with the one that chronologically happens first in the late 1970s, season two, and then he'll get to experience the offspring of Solverman, who's an important character in season one. Set in, I believe, what, 2005 or something?
I'm watching them in season order.
Okay. All right.
Not experimental like he is. I have a recommendation, and it is for you gentlemen, and it's for all of our listeners, and a sincere recommendation that will elevate our discussion on certain topics on this show.
Okay.
I avoided this book for a while, and not the least of which because the cover looked like the worst, most boring O'Reilly's book ever. And I know that's a silly way to judge a book, but I'm like, man, that's just kind of not really kind of exciting or cool for the premise of what this book is going to be about. But nonetheless, I was looking for something to listen to while I drove back and forth to my best friend Ken Montgomery's wedding, not to be confused with my best friend Justin Robert Young's wedding earlier in 2015. This book deals with artificial intelligence, or more specifically, superintelligence by Nick Bostrom.
Superintelligence by Nick Bostrom. Is this an Audible joint that you're showing us?
This is an Audible book. So Bostrom is a philosopher. He's at Oxford. He's actually trained in economics. And it deals with, he goes through all the different scenarios by which we would develop highly intelligent machines. And he uses the term superintelligent, either from brain uploading to just computers, just creating them from, you know, simple computer programs that are seed programs that evolve into something more sophisticated. And it is I'm halfway into it, just an amazing overview of that, of all the ways at which we can arrive at there, then all of the problems that we can see. And he points out that, hey, these are the problems we see, but when we're talking about superintelligence, it's super intelligent. And how do you contain these things? How do you prevent them from causing harm? Would they want to cause harm?
All right,
and he gives examples of things of we've talked about like gray goo before, but you tell a super intelligent machine to say, hey, make paper clips. And it quickly realizes that it can turn the entire universe to computronium to figure out how to maximize the number of paper clips it can produce. And by the way, goodbye humanity, because you're
I'm here to build paper clips.
Exactly. And he gets very much into that, and he does a very good example of explaining how we tend to try to anthropomorphize intelligences like our own, and he says there's no reason to think that they would behave like us. And we've had this argument back and forth, you know, Brian and I, about would they see us as their parents or whatever, and he describes these are utterly alien intelligences that have no concept of those things, or that those concepts are no more meaningful to them than your relationship to you and your fingernails. And that's my example. And also the problems, and it's a very interesting problem, is you say, okay, well, let's build one of these artificial intelligence inside of a box, inside of a sandbox, and we'll find out if it's moral or not. And he's like, well, a evildoer and a good one are going to act exactly the same. You'll have no way to tell, which if you see the movie Ex Machina, that's one of the things that delves into, is the idea of how do you know? And very, very, very interesting, very good, just, and it gets into like graphs, and it's interesting in the Audible, like these, they start talking about formulas and stuff, and some of it seems is kind of high level. Nonetheless, really digging it, and we're totally screwed. We're totally doomed.
All right, I just picked it up. As a matter of fact, there it is right there. I grabbed Big Super Call. Intelligence. I spent my last Audible credit on it, so I'm excited to give that a try.
Sweet.
Yeah, the core idea is that if you have an intelligence, a super intelligence, that's idea that if it wants to increase its efficiency or maximize its utility, it would look upon, it would say, okay, well, I want to cover the entire planet with solar panels. Right. And it's like, no purpose for us. Or it could, you give it, he gives these different situations, like, oh, let's say you have one and you tell it, like, hey, your goal is to make me happy. And so the computer's like, oh, you know what? If I just put some electrodes into your pleasure sensor in your brain, and I can make you happy all the time. Or it says, you know what I can do is I can upload you into my system and then put you into a pleasure state and put that on an infinite loop.
I mean, that sounds pretty rad.
I did what you asked. What more do you need?
Kind of okay with this. So far, so good.
Yeah, this is really amazing. The idea that, like, can humanity survive the early days of you having your TiVo for, like, super intelligence, where it just doesn't quite know exactly what it should be recording, and, you know, like the Patton Oswalt bit. That's amazing.
All right, so I got a question for you, since we have a little bit of extra time. You want to take
also I got another pick.
Oh, great, go.
I saw Hateful Eight,
and
saw the 70mm Roadshow, which it clocks in at about 3 hours, including an intermission.
Wow.
I can't objectively review Tarantino films for people that are not Tarantino fans, because I love Tarantino so much. I will say, if you loved Quentin Tarantino, this is basically the all-star game. You have a bunch of people that are great at reading Quentin Tarantino dialogue. They all just say really clever, fun things. Also the N-word a bunch of times. There's all the Tarantino tropes that you know and love. And even in, you even kind of get elements of the past characters that they have that they have played, not in any kind of plot sense, but just in vocal inflections and facial muggings. Like, it just is this super, for me, it's like, listen, it ain't about the movie. I mean, the movie's good, right? It doesn't exactly have the narrative propulsion that that you've seen with other Quentin Tarantino films. However, it is just, you know, tremendously fun to watch.
Did the 70mm projection really pop out to you? Did you visually feel like I'm seeing something fundamentally different from other movies that I watch?
No.
I figured. Because since it was filmed, did you notice any jitter or anything?
I mean, like, it looks like film. I mean, like, I bless his heart. And bless heart everybody who's just got this film boner. But it's like a digital one, and it won for a million different reasons. And like, there is certainly, I assume, a nostalgia for some people that can really notice. You can see the film grain, but is it any different than a million different projects that put a slight film grain digitally over top of their shots? No.
I'll tell you what.
Fargo is a great example of a show that very deliberately at times tries to look of its era and therefore it apes a kind of film sort of look and puts film grain. It doesn't, to me, look much different than watching an actual film projection.
What about the criticism I've heard that it's a very great dialogue, but it's like the most elaborate Quentin Tarantino table read?
Yeah, that's there. I mean, like,
I actually just made that up.
Yeah, no, I mean, that's it's so funny because in the program they give you, it explains the history of The Hateful Eight. And it's like, oh, started as a live read that he did, which is funny that they start there and not at Gawker leaking the script, which led Tarantino to throw a huge hissy fit, say he wasn't making the movie and was only going to do this table read because he wanted to have it out there and that was going to be it. It was never going to be a movie. It's very talky. There are times where, I mean, it shows you how great of a director Tarantino is that like a bunch of people in a cabin seems as interesting as it is. And it doesn't just like shot reverse shot you until you are comatose.
Right.
But it's great. I thought it was super fun and surprises that I did not see coming and I was not aware of.
Quick question. I want you guys to make a quick gamble because we're touching back on stuff that we've talked about before, but there's been new news. What are the odds that the number one box office grossing movie of 2016 will be one that launched in 2015? Like, what are the odds that Star Wars makes enough money just in 2016, not counting its opening, not counting the holiday, not counting any of that, just starting in January? What are the odds that its total from now takes it to the number one for the year?
Domestic?
Yeah. Because it's already, I mean, it's stomping. It just, we're recording this on Sunday night, and the word is that it pulled in another $88 million this weekend. So I would include this weekend in 2016.
Yeah, so you got to figure it's got a the top movie of 2016. You've got Civil War looks amazing and awesome. I'm sure that'll clock in really big.
So call it what, $500 million.
Yeah, I think generous. That'd be high end, but yeah. I think, yeah. Then you've got Rogue One, which...
Oh, it's got to compete with another Star Wars movie! That's a good point.
Which will no doubt have the final trailer for 8 on it, right?
Yeah.
I have talked to people, like, I was talking to my friend's kids, you know, they're 17 and 21. They love Star Wars, super into it, super excited about it. They loved it. They saw it, and they just been talking Star Wars and Star Wars theories and all that. I'm like, yeah, and it's cool because we don't have to wait long till the next Star Wars movie. And the kid's like, yeah, you know, May 2017. I go, oh no, young man. You're getting one this next December. And then I explained to them Rogue One, and I watched this girl's eyes just widen as high school seniors. I'm like, oh no, there's another one. And this is all about stealing the Death Star plans. Like, really? I'm like, yeah. So it's kind of cool because if you're a fan, you know, but it's not on the radar of most of the people going in there. And it was smart to not do a preview. It was smart not to split the narrative.
Yeah, agreed. Speaking of which, I'm just going to assume we're all on the same page that Rogue One will be way, way better than the Star Wars that we just saw, like Episode 7, just because unfettered from the need to, you know, create scenes that rhyme and to continue stories and make winks to the past. Like, if it's just a really good heist combat movie and there's no force and everything, it's like, I think it could be the best thing ever.
I mean, I think it's going to be awesome. Like, I think now we're in this fun place like we are with the Marvel movies where it's just like, you know, do I prefer Captain America over Iron Man or Iron Man over Captain America. Like, I don't know. Like, I really enjoyed all of them. Like, I think that they're super great. I could see where somebody would be a huge fan of it. You know, the further I get from episode 7, the more I like it. The more I'm just so jazzed by it, and I'm so jazzed talking about it. And you know, I think Rogue One's gonna be great, man. I think, but like the idea that it'll be better. I mean, who knows, right?
There's the big releases we have to look forward to, Nick, this year are like Rogue One, Civil War, which I'm over the moon for already from that trailer. I just those stories are far more exciting to me than the Avengers stories. This is just more compelling, more interesting to me, and we'll see. And James Gunn says it's one of the best Avengers, one of the best Marvel movies yet. So we'll see.
Civil
and
War
then we got Batman versus Superman.
Yeah, which, by the way, I remain optimistic. Everyone loves to hate on it. I think there's good chances. Although the trailers, I think they've done a very poor job of selling it to people in the trailers. But I think it could be a rubbery, fun video game version of the DC universe.
There's a review of the film on DC. What was the Reddit? Andrew, it's like DC movie fan.reddit.com
something. Yeah,
well, I definitely saw somebody had assembled essentially a complete plot synopsis based on all the stuff that's leaked and been put out there.
It actually reminded me so much of back in the 90s with Ain't It Cool News, where you would just get these like, oh, I was at a test screening and I saw the movie. They lay out everything that happens in the movie, and let's just say if fan service is your game, then I think DC people might, you know, whatever flaws might be in that plot might be, you know, just they're just gonna put in enough fan service to smooth over the cracks. So,
and I left out X-Men Apocalypse and Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them.
That might do huge. I think the new Harry Potter, if that's good, that could be gigantic.
The Finding Nemo sequel this year.
Oh yeah, Finding Dory.
Finding Dory.
I don't know. I'm starting to wonder how much of The Shine is starting to scrape off the old Pixar chrome.
Toy Story 2 was pretty good. It was a good sequel to a good movie. I don't know.
It was.
Cars
2 was not so good.
No.
Yeah, for me, Pixar used to be, every year I really super looked forward to the next Pixar movie. And then it was like around like Ratatouille, I liked, but I'm like, it's not. And it certainly was designed to make critics. I liked it, but I didn't feel like, this is the magical transformative sort of Pixar thing. And then when Cars came out, I'm like, oh man, this is a movie for kids. And it's a merchandising play. It became the number one merchandise brand for several years. And then I still have yet to see Brave or Inside Out.
Yeah, I haven't seen Brave. I really dug Inside Out, but, and I haven't seen The Good Dinosaur, but them releasing two movies in a year was kind of a...
Yeah, well, that was not so much them releasing two movies in a year as them finally deciding they had to get Good Dinosaur out the door.
Yeah. That's hard, man. Like, because it's so well worn territory at this point. Since we've had 9 Ice Age movies, and you know, it's like, it just kind of felt like, well, I mean, you're Pixar. You're like the only people that can have, you know, you the other movie you did was like an esoteric look into our inner monologues and how they shape, our young minds. It's like, and then the next one is kind of like about as animated tropey as you can get, from Land Before Time to Ice Age.
Yeah, it's when you're at the point where if I tell you a synopsis and you can't tell if it's a DreamWorks movie or Pixar or Blue Sky, then
yeah,
that's
then they're not where they want to be. I don't know. I mean, to Brian's question, I don't think.
Oh yeah, Deadpool. We're all looking forward to Deadpool. I don't know if it'll be giant like the other ones though.
Yeah, I think from here on out. So this week. Star Wars The Force Awakens will become, within 3 weeks of its release, the highest grossing domestic box office champ. what it does from here, you know, you got to figure it's got a real hell of a shot at a billion. You know, that seems very likely at this point.
So of which 400 million plus would be in 2016. So unless we're seeing a movie that's going to shatter 400 billion, it seems like there's a chance that that could be the case.
But I think we have some potential ones that could do that, though.
Sure. Well, I mean, I guess it's astonishing to me. To me, the story is not whether or not it makes it. The story is the mere fact that there's an argument to be made that that could happen is incredible.
Oh yeah. In a time before prequels, we talked about a new Star Wars should theoretically be the number one movie of all time, and it would have been had it been something like this. And then Avatar came out, and then after Titanic, that was like when the prequels were coming out. Like, well, you're thinking like, this should be Titanic, and then you see them, we're like, no, this is not going to be Titanic. And now we have a movie that's going to beat Titanic, and it's going to beat Avatar domestically.
Titanic, yeah.
Yeah, what about internationally?
We will see. I'll tell you what, I have a lot of thoughts about creativity, specifically with the George Lucas interview that I think we should get.
Oh, you know what? Let's take all that to After Things. I think it's a great idea.
We are going to do a retro version of After Things for the fans right after we wrap this up.
Gentlemen, it's been weird.
Yeah. All right, I'm going to run and go pee-pee in the potty.
Yeah, everybody, let's go do bathroom breaks.
What if I don't want to, Bryce? What if I don't want to?
You're going to go pee, Andrew.
You'll have to, actually.
I'm good, thank you.
Go to the pot.
Oh, God. My back.
Wow, Hateful Eight is really underperforming.
Is it? When did it actually open up to wide release?
I mean, I think it's what? Last week?
Oh, really? Oh.
You want to know what's doing really well?
What is?
Daddy's Home.
Yeah, you know, I wonder if it's just like, because I feel like, I was going to say that sister movie has got a lot of press and promotion, but it's only doing 61 million.
Yeah, I think people just really like Will Ferrell and Mark Wahlberg, man. Mm-hmm. You know, that movie is apparently hot bags of shit, but. Mm-hmm. And we spoiled it on Trollcast.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
I've been hearing a lot of good things about The Big Short.
Yeah, I mean, that there's always going to just be. I mean, that's at 33.8 million now, but it's outgrossing The Hateful Eight. Hateful Eight's at 29.5.
Yeah. And Malunga bought it for cheaper on the draft.
Yeah, I don't know how much farther The Big Short goes, though. Yeah. I feel like that's kind of what I mean. Like that probably tapers off, and you know, if it can push to 40, you know, good for it, but. I think that's pretty much gotten what it's gonna get. Yeah. Hateful Eight might stick around a little bit more, but you know, I don't know. I mean, it's kind of a bit of a different situation with Hateful Eight. And once everybody sees it, there is something that I do want to talk about that I think would have affected its total gross.
Cool. So I actually went and saw Star Wars over my little vacation.
What'd you think?
So I hadn't seen the other Star Wars movies, so a lot of it was, you know, connecting the dots. And I think mostly the movie is pretty good and accessible.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't like know everything, but. It's the kind of thing where I was sitting in the theater after it was done. I was like, that was a good movie. And as I was thinking about it, I was like, well, I don't remember anything too exciting. Like, I remember walking away from it being like, oh, that was, I mean, this is a dumb realization, but it's a war movie.
Mm-hmm.
Set in the stars. And part of my, I think maybe I had a mishandled expectation going in thinking it would be like a Marvel movie, which is like a roller coaster with two big loop-de-loops at the end.
Mm-hmm.
Where Star Wars was more... I think it sold me enough to watch the episode 8.
The people of your generation that are getting the most out of it were the ones that went and said, "Oh, let me watch the early ones and so I can kind of get an idea what this is all about."
Yeah.
It's not like what? Lord of the Rings where you're probably at an advantage if you haven't read the book. You know, you're Lord of the Rings, the movies, you just go in, you're like, "Oh, this is all there," and you're not going, "Oh, wait, what about this story, or what about that, or what about this?" And so I think that I understand, like, yeah, for you, like, "Oh, that's a cool movie," but it's not like it's not a part of this bigger thing for you.
Right. And I could tell kind of when it was done, that was like, I think if I had seen those other movies, I would have had a bigger emotional response, especially with the ending. Or even just the battle sequences, which I don't know. They feel weird when you haven't.
So, Brian, I have to ask, We won't spoil anything about the ending, but all right. I'm gonna go into soft spoiler zone night right here. Cool.
about which thing?
Force Awakens.
Oh yeah, sure.
Just soft spoiler. Did Penny cry?
Yeah. Dude, I got choked up. I was surprised.
Yeah, just curious. So Ken Montgomery, his daughter, she's 10.
Yeah.
Cried.
Yeah.
Cried over probably the same moment. And I'm thinking, she had gone and seen the other ones, and so she had a connection to that. Mm. And so, you know, and then she's like, "Yeah, I cried when blank, blank thing happened," you know. And I'm like, wow. And now it's touching because it's like, because these were kids that were born after the prequels even, yeah. You know. But it was interesting to see that, like, both of them had this, that situation meant as much to them at 10 as it would have meant to us at 10.
Mm-hmm.
All of our friend, Brett Rounceville, just watched the original trilogy for the first time, had never seen the original trilogy.
What a weirdo.
Went to go see episode 7. His review is, if you don't believe that episode 7 is the best Star Wars movie made, you saw the original trilogy when you were too young.
Ha! So him with the cold, steely eyes of a mid 30 years old was able to evaluate them all and say, "This is the best of all of them."
Well, I mean, his point was like, yeah, because his point was like, yeah, it's paced like a movie. You know, like movies that you see now and they're great, like it's paced like that and it's fun. You know, so but that's it was interesting to see his perspective on it.
Yeah. It's well, we've talked about my complex relationship with episode 7.
Yes.
But my one word answer is, or one sentence answer is, I love it.
Yeah.
And then, you know, there's plenty of asterisks there, but it's just what it was able to do and what it was able to achieve, and every bit of its success is earned.
Yeah. All right. Yeah, let's keep talking about Star Wars.
Ready to begin?
Yep.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the After Things podcast. I'm Andrew Main, joined by Brian Brushwood.
It's true. That's a true fact. You can't deny it. I mean, you could deny it, but you'd have to prove it in a court of law. I have DNA evidence.
Justin and Justin Robert Young.
Well, yeah, you know, when I was first starting, you know, I said to Marty, I'm like, you know, I just want to make a movie, you know.
Man, that we used to do this skit, and we'd be driving in a car to entertain ourselves, and we would be talking about Star Wars, and we'd be like, hey George, we're not going to be able to put this weird stop motion thing into the scene of Han Solo, and George Lucas would be like, "You're ruining my movie." Again.
What do you mean he can't be a frog? This movie's ruined.
We would take like all the things that we heard that he wanted to do and that he couldn't do, and then would be like, yeah, it's ruined.
Didn't he think that the cantina scene ruined the movie because, like, I guess the menagerie of aliens wasn't to his liking?
Well, yeah, he went back and shot more scenes. They added more aliens in that.
Ah.
So it's that was sort of our funny thing, was just the idea that this creator who created this great thing kind of didn't know all the ways, the reasons that it be, which choices made it good and which ones did not. And that was just our funny thing, is Justin, you're ruining my movie. Well, there's also the fact that ruined movie.
There's also the fact that at Star Wars Celebration last year, I was on the phone, and it was, this was one of my top nine liked photos on Instagram. I was a George Lucas, old George Lucas, current George Lucas cosplayer, came up to take a picture with me while I was on the phone, thinking I was a young George Lucas cosplayer. When really I was just wearing a flannel shirt and, you know, trying to mind my business.
All right. So, speaking of George, St. George.
Who we love and we absolutely owe an entire wonderful, joyful childhood to.
Exactly. So this is my point. I have said, now that Force Awakens is good, everybody loves it, it's the highest grossing movie of all time, everything is right in the Star Wars universe, even now, whatever criticism of the movie has been dwarfed by people's theories about who is what and when things are going to happen and what is going to be brought back, what elements of the extended universe might be roped in. There's a million different things. It is where we want to be as Star Wars fans. I have been adamant that this is when the healing would take place with the fans' relationship with George Lucas, that now that we are reset, he did the brave thing to release Star Wars when it had outgrown him. That takes bravery. And then,
I mean, it seems like
the Rose interview happened. Now I'm out. You deserve all of this, George.
I was about to say, it's like, it seems like the only way to screw things up is to inject yourself and criticize the one thing everybody universally loves.
For those of you that don't know. George Lucas talked about Charlie Rose, talked to Charlie Rose about selling Star Wars, and he made the observation that it's his kids, that he gave his kids, and it's like selling your kids off to white slavers. He immediately apologized for that via a Disney press release.
Well, and what's funny also is like, it's almost like the offensive part isn't the obvious misuse of the phrase white slavers. Like, that's the least offensive part to me in this whole thing.
Yeah. All right, and it's not that this is an excuse for other times when people do weird behavior like that, you know, Ted Danson walking on stage dressed in inappropriately.
Blackface. Yeah.
Lucas is like, he's married to a black gal, so he's obviously not, you know, some guy sitting in some white supremacist sort of point of view, and he was trying to articulate the phrase in such a way, but I think he has very, very, very open, broad-minded views on these things, and that was not intended to be, and he immediately apologized when that was pointed out to the perception of that, and so that's not what the controversy is really about, you know, about him dissing what happened to Star Wars.
So the two big things that he says about Episode 7 is that did you guys watch the full interview?
No. Yeah, so. You got to take me through all the highlights.
Okay. Well, I mean, he seems a bit defensive or salty about how Disney did not want his treatments. You know, he makes the point that, hey, you know, every director is their own little megalomaniac and needs everything very specifically. And so when I realized that I was not going to be part of this, I just decided that I needed to step back. And here's the key. He says, what we got with The Force Awakens is a retro movie. It is something for the fans, which, George uses with all of the, all of the warmth of somebody of George Wallace using, you know, coded words about, you know, bringing America back to where it used to be. He says that it is, not what he would have done. He would have worked very, very hard to bring in new planets and new aliens and not have everything be too much of an echo of what had happened. That, I think, his description of the movie, I think, is kind of echoes in a way that is you know, has landed the way that it did with everybody, because he's got this, like, he's so defensive. He spends half the movie, or sorry, half the interview with Charlie Rose talking about how he's going to make movies that you can't see. Like, coming back to it. Like, I'm just going to make, you know, I'm going to make some films, and I'm gonna, like, I'm just going to show them to my friends. And, you know, and
Charlie Rose is like, Magic and Red Tails.
Yeah, well, I mean, so he's very bitter. I mean, like, this is something that's very well known, you know, that he is bitter about the system. He's got very specific and highly political views of what gets out, you know, and why it gets out. He is very bitter about Red Tails. He is very but he just keeps coming back to this idea of, like, oh, I just want to show it to my friends. I just want to show it to other directors so other directors can see what I'm doing, and that, you know, that affects them. And, you know, like, that's what directors do. You know, you show these movies to each other. Charlie was like, so I won't get to see him? He's like, well, I mean, maybe you, you know, I'll call you. Oh, nobody else.
Northern California billionaire socialist filmmaker.
I mean, is there, let me ask you guys this, because this is something that the more I think about it, the more I think it's totally correct, that it takes such bravery to let Star Wars go for him.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. Well, and he had the double whammy where it's like, all of a sudden I deeply regretted all the criticisms I'd lobbed over the last decade or two. When he says, yeah, no, I'm going to give Star Wars to more talented people than me, and I'm going to take all that money and give it to charity. It's like that double whammy of setting Star Wars free and doing good. How great is that?
I think that's great. And I think that, But he kind of, you know, whenever we have a new president, the classy thing for the last president to do is to kind of wait a year or wait a little while before saying, hey, you know what? You know, and when you hand the keys to somebody, this movie's still in theaters. It's still in theaters, and he's talking about his frustration with it.
And,
you know, he's,
and by the way, it made me realize, man, I guess I can't. We'd have to give a minor spoiler disclaimer, but it's like, after having seen the movie and seeing JJ, you remember JJ Abrams did that thing where he took questions from random celebrities and people he knew. If you remember George Lucas's question, it seems rather pointed and maybe not nice given what you learn in the movie. And that's a lot to ask people to reconstruct from memory. You could put the pieces together yourself. But when I first watched it, I was like, oh, that's cute. George Lucas is just asking you about a random silly topic. And instead, and if you look at JJ's reaction, he's just like, oh, what is this? Yeah, instead it's a giant freaking spoiler he's asking about. And it's like, well, what is that, man?
Yeah. I'm going to throw a theory out here, and I'm not going to, again, and I caveat, I so much joy in my childhood was because of his imagination, what he created. I think that part of what, if you read, again, we highly recommend the textbook for the Weird Things show, or for After Things, should be How Star Wars Conquered the Universe by Chris Taylor.
Absolutely.
And then if you kind of like get into some of the things that happened sort of after that, the cycle of that book, Lucas would have this sort of thing where he'd have periods where Star Wars merchandising was very big and he'd make a lot of money. And then he would kind of spend that money and do different projects and stuff. And then he would come back and sort of do something new, like he did the prequels, et cetera. Leading up to the prequels, he did the re-releases. And the re-releases were very successful. He re-released all the movies, did the updated. That's why he made the specialized them. So that was an excuse for them to come back to theaters. And that helped finance the prequels. That was part of the deal because he likes to self-finance. Ever since Empire, he's paid for the stuff out of pocket, so he's not beholden to a studio, and he can do whatever he wanted. So there was about 5 years ago, 6 years ago, the plan was that there was the talk of he wanted to do the Star Wars TV show, Star Wars Underworld, whatever, but he couldn't get a network because no network would commit to buying 100 episodes outright, which Shocker. You're kidding. He had Ronald D. Moore. He had some great, great TV writers, great people working with him on this. They wrote all the scripts for this. But that was sort of just put on hold because it just he couldn't get anybody to go in and go buy that, which even in this age of Netflix and the success of HBO and Amazon, I don't see them saying, yeah, we'll buy 100 Sight Unseen, considering there needs to be a feedback mechanism or whatever. So anyhow, the plan was is that he was going to do a re-release of all six films in 3D. Do you remember this?
Oh, did we only get the Phantom Menace, didn't we?
We only got the Phantom Menace, and I think it made maybe $38 million total, which if you figure out what the cost was to actually do the transfer, the cost of all the prints and everything, all the stuff that they cost in there, I think it lost money. Yeah. I think that it absolutely didn't, at least Phantom Menace, it didn't do well. And
part of the problem is that it's the Phantom Menace, right? Like if he had just started with them in chronological order.
Brian. We see that problem from Lucas's point of view. Lucas doubles down on, oh, kids who grew up during Phantom Menace.
A lot of kids, Phantom Menace is their movie, and you know, I have kids all the time come up and tell me that they love the Phantom
Menace. Kids watch Clone Wars, that's their favorite. And so he believes that, and that's his mentality. So starts a Phantom Menace, and if you look at their trajectory, what would happen at those releases, you know that each one's going to make less than the next one, right? Mm-hmm. And that's what happened to special editions, is that there was, like, I think Empire may have done a little bit better than the others or something, I'm not sure, but by the time you got to Jedi,
Empire was the least agonizing of the special editions.
Oh, yeah. But by the time you got to Jedi, did the least of all three, and a really great series you can build up, like the later Harry Potter films just did monster because just that built-up anticipation. But anyhow, that came out, and that was a thing that he thought was going to be a big moneymaker, and it was not. It was not, and so the five other films, that entire thing got canceled, and then within like a year, we're hearing, hey, Disney's making a deal. And for him, it's like, well, you know, people probably don't like Star Wars anymore. Now, I mean, I think that was his perception, because, you know, Clone Wars was doing good, but it wasn't doing fantastic on Cartoon Network. It was a show that it was more offset by the merchandising than it was by what they were getting paid per episode. And he put a lot of money and effort into the Clone Wars cartoon. You look at what Rebels, I really think is a better written show, but it doesn't have anywhere near as many characters or backgrounds or exotic scenes going on because it's a much smaller show.
But I will give a huge thumbs up to Rebels. In fact, that's my pick as of right now. It's amazing.
Brian, I love Rebels too, but when you watch an episode, you realize, oh yeah, they're probably far fewer animators working on this than Clone Wars, but where it counts, it matters. Yeah. So anyway, my theory is that basically based upon the failure of the 3D re-releases, that Lucas decided that's one of the motivating factors for him was financials, why it was time to unload.
Do you think he'll ever be able to get out of his own way long enough for us, for the fan mass, the Star Wars fan mass to redeem him and think of
to embrace him?
There's not a collection of fans in the world that he could not walk in front of and he would not get a standing ovation.
Agreed. Fair point. Yeah.
We will cheer him, and that was the thing that we watched the Star Wars Celebration event was kind of like, I kind of wish that they did at that event, hey, this is all because of George. But yeah. I know internally the mandate was, in all the promos and all the stuff, minimize the prequels. Do not emphasize that because marketing tells them that would be bad. And that was just not where they wanted to go forward. And you look at how hard they worked to do that. You know, they're told, people I know who work for Disney said, yeah, we're told to pretty much pretend they don't exist.
Well, and here's the funny part is I can see, and I love the fact that you pointed out that Rogue One is going to be the first awesome prequel, right? I can see those side stories just stepping back and back and back farther until before we know it, all of a sudden, you know, we see the likes of Yoda again and we're back in the prequel universe. But at this point, we just have so many movies that they make us fall in love with the prequel world in a way that we didn't the first time around.
Yeah, but it's after watching Force Awakens, and like many people, I went home and I'm like, I watched a little Star Wars, I watched a little Empire, you know, first 20 minutes of Empire, whatever, just amazing. And that was a great choice by Lucas. Like, I decided to put the battle scene up front. I'm like, yeah, that worked great. And it ends in characters. So, and then I'm like, man, you know, I kind of got a hankering for more Star Wars. What do I want to do? I'm like, Do I go watch the prequels? Do I maybe just watch a little prequels? Do I watch a little prequels? I'm like, you know what? I'm just going to watch Spaceballs instead. Which I did, and I loved.
I mean, you're right. Like, I think that there will always be an element of fan, you know, the fan contingency that will always have a very complicated relationship. But he is, you know, yeah, you're right. Anywhere he walks into any room, and he's going to get a big round of applause for him.
I mean, it's a little bit like all those crap-talking magicians who are rolling their eyes at David Blaine, but the second he walks into his room, they're all diving to have their picture taken with him. You know, it's like...
Yeah, but I mean, even more so that it's hard because we don't have an example. And we sometimes can think of musicians or artists that later on, if you have some emotional connection, you feel like, oh, they betrayed me or something. But with him, it's sort of like, yeah, we think he had it. He was, his finger was on the pulse then, and then he just didn't get it. And that's sort of the common sort of thing is like, yeah. And among fans, we kind of like, man, there are a lot of really capable people working on the originals, and that's why they were so good. And so it just, George doesn't understand, to me, you know, my impression.
Do you think he will be able to not step on his own wiener?
No.
Again?
No.
Nope.
I have zero confidence. He is the Jar Jar of his own career. He's constantly stepping in the poodoo.
Misa, sorry. So can I pitch you guys an idea for a TV show?
Hit us up.
Yeah.
We go back thousands of years in the Old Republic era, or before the Old Republic.
Back to Knights of the Old Republic, that era, sure.
Sort of like that, yeah. You know, the Force is very this raw sort of thing. They're still figuring out Sith, and we can take from the books what we want or whatever we do or we don't want. But basically, you central, and it's just where people are just starting to go expand into the galaxy, and you already got like in one version of the Star Wars canon, like the dudes with the weird greenish heads and the glowing eyes and the cantina were like the first ones to sort of conquer a big part of the Star Wars galaxy. And you kind of have that, like there's an other race there that's sort of been there, and humans are starting to make it out there, but maybe they've got a few planets, a few whatever that they're conquering or whatever they're living on. Game of Thrones style Star Wars.
All of it.
I love it there's the situation in which I love it is in a, you know, absent of the rest of the world, as it exists today. The situation in which I don't, but I keep tripping over the fact that I'm trying to fit it in with the current way they're doing things. And that's obviously, I can't see that compatibility working for what they're doing right now. I don't know. Like 5 years from now, yes, but not today. It's hard for me to see it.
Well, I mean, Kathleen Kennedy has said that they're actively looking into television, and one of the reasons that they look into that is that they look at Star Wars can be another Marvel type property, and Marvel functions with, you have Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., which people who watch that show love that show. You have Daredevil, which we love. We have Jessica Jones, which a lot of people who made it all the way through really, really love. And you're doing interesting things in different spaces. And then there's cartoons for kids and stuff. And for television, and particularly if they wanted to do broadcast, if you're trying to figure out how to capitalize on young viewers, male and female viewers between 18 and 35, and still get them on broadcast, look what CBS is doing in Star Trek. They're actually trying to sell a net product, but again, it's because they have advertisers they want to be able to target and go after. Internally, we know that with Disney, ESPN numbers have been fleeing subscriptions, but they've been picking up online subscriptions for ESPN. And so it may be an exaggerated thing. People I've talked to are internally say, no, it's not as quite as bad as what it seems. We've got a lot of people internally are now subscribing to the net versions of that. It becomes an extremely attractive package if ABC wants to say, hey, subscribe to ABC or some package like that, a Star Wars TV show.
Okay, so on that regard, I love the fact that Bryce has pulled up this one of the hottest video game, most anticipated properties. Mm-hmm. One of the pieces of collateral was the Star Wars 1313. Took place on, it was about the dark underbelly of Coruscant and like that kind of thing. Could totally see as a TV show, and maybe that's what you meant by Game of Thrones kind of world. Like I was thinking
go get away from, I think 1313 could have been cool, or Star Wars Underworld 2. Those things look, they could be visually cool, but also right now in the age that we have of The Expanse and a lot of other sci-fi drama out there that kind of sort of wants to inhabit that sort of space, it might look, it may be lost. But if you said, no, let's go, let's dial it way back in a different way. But either way, I think I would just make an argument. I would love to see this more of when the Force was like magic kind
of thing.
I
think a big part of the seeing that Rogue One is coming out, I think really scratches a big part of the itch of the that 1313 had me excited for. And so, in fact, it makes me think that maybe it's a smart thing, just as it was a painful thing to lose the expanded universe. It ended up being the right thing because we had mystery going into the new series. It was a painful thing to lose 1313, but I think Rogue One will scratch that itch in much the same way. I still would love to see all of the non-force aspects of this world. I think really excite me a lot.
And I think we're getting that. I think that's you know, that is certainly something that we will have delivered upon. But if we are going to keep a theme of...
Wait, I'm just going to make a prediction. Let me interrupt for a second.
Oh, go.
I predict this year we'll hear a Star Wars TV show announcement.
Oh, yeah. No, I'm down with that. I agree.
And you're totally right. That thing is a success at press release, right? Yeah. Like, you know, either it's going to be a huge network, you know, commitment, or if it's Netflix or you know, an online property, like there's just...
Yeah, and a story that can be told over, you know, that befits television versus something else where... I'm sorry to interrupt you, but that's my prediction.
We have a theme for this after things. It is overweight, graying, controversial creators.
Why did you have to bring me into this?
Oh, stop it. George R. R. Martin wrote on his live journal, which is always my favorite thing to say. His emotion was depressed. He told his fans that despite the fact that he swore up and down that he was going to have The Winds of Winter, the new book, out before Game of Thrones debuted its new season, and that he, as he details, he went to his publisher. The publisher said, hey, listen, if you can have it to us before October, we can have it out by the beginning of 2016. He blew that deadline. They said, all right, guess what? Forget that. We were just trying to spook you. Turns out we talked to Henry at the plant. We're going to figure it out. It's going to be fine. Can you hear me?
Yeah. Sorry, your hand hit something and USBs went aflutter.
Oh, no, it's actually, you know what it is? We got this dishwasher that is, like, flickering the power.
That's amazing, yeah. No, everything's fine. Keep going.
Okay, they're like, all right, guess what? Talk to the guys at the plant. If you can just get it to us by New Year's Eve, we just need it by New Year's Eve, we can have it out before the new season comes in. He blew that deadline. It's not going to be out before the series, and he doesn't think it might not be out this year at all. He is returning to his, you know, wait and see kind of attitude. This is obviously a song as old as time. George R. R. Martin doesn't have a book out when we want him to.
You know what? Let me be the first on behalf of the internet. On behalf of people who love Game of Thrones, on behalf of people who want to live, maybe not in all of the universe that he created, let me be the first to say, George, take it easy. Do what you got to do. Whenever it's ready, it's ready. And you know what? If it's never ready, what can you do? It's a tough life. Listen, I want you to do yourself. Take the night off. Schedule yourself a pub crawl. Check out some NFL games. Blog about them.
Do another film festival in your movie theater you built.
Yeah, build another theater. Yeah, do whatever you like.
I agree. I'm totally at this point. Like, even as a fan of the books, I'm just like, what's the point of even like having an expectation?
You know, this comes down to this perception, and it's interesting when you listen to J.J. Abrams and Lawrence Kasdan talking about making another Star Wars film, and there is, and part of the frustration for many people, like I had a friend who wrote an entire screed on Facebook when they threw out the expanded universe and just like, I'm done, I'm over with this. This is it's a betrayal. Brian, your emotions times 100, okay?
Yeah.
This guy was just, nothing upset him more. 9/11 wasn't as impactful to him as that was. and it was this weird, pervasive point of view that we often have that these things are somehow real and that artists are channeling this, that there is a complete Star Wars story, not just the one that Lucas says, oh, I have this, but no, there is this thing. There is this beginning, middle, and end out there somewhere. And it's the job of whoever's in charge of that to tell us what this is and not just make it up as they go along. And that's what, you know, kind of with Abrams, you kind of were like, yeah, no, it's just like, it's what could episode 8, they could all die at the beginning. Doesn't matter. It's whatever they want to do. And with George R. R. Martin in this sort of this very real world, the more real these worlds feel to us, the harder it is for us. I'm like, why does it take so long to the books? Just tell us what happened. He's like, well, because he's actually making it up, guys. He's not like, you know, getting, you know, in the libraries of Westeros writing down this account.
I mean, at the end of the day, we're all, you know, just warriors gathered around a campfire and somebody's standing up to tell their story. And the only power we have is whether or not we clap at the end of it, you know?
But we think that we get into, many of us get invested in the idea that the story is somehow real. The story is somehow, and not to say that people really think this place is real, but they think
but,
that
there's somehow some kind of inherent rightness and wrongness
exactly,
to doing it. Yeah.
Exactly.
It's like, no, it's all made up stories. The only thing you get to do is, you know, in the old days, it was whether you would clap at the campfire. Nowadays, it's whether you vote with your dollars. And, you know, that's it.
Do you think that he is... You know, like, you know, let's play sports talk radio. Does this hurt his legacy? Will he be remembered as somebody who more often, you know, is he damaging his creative output by how slow he is putting out?
No, we're gonna forget about delays. We don't remember delays. We remember the final product 10 years afterwards, right? My guess is he's doing better by his legacy by making the difficult choice of breaking a promise today so that 3 months from now he can keep his deeper promise to have a good book moving forward.
I mean, you can certainly say his publishers are a little annoyed that some of these books are going to come out after the show is done and HBO and Time Warner Corporation are done pouring a gigantic amount of press and awareness so people, you know, will also buy the books. Like,
yeah.
Financially, it's something that they are surely very, very, very frustrated by, right?
Oh, absolutely. I would imagine
as soon as the show's done, it's just going to go back to being, it's like what Lord of the Rings is now, right? It's like Lord of the Rings, super hot when the movies are out, mm-hmm. right? Like this is really, really hot because the show's out. And then eventually it'll be more popular than it was before, but it'll just kind of be a rad fantasy series that fantasy readers read and like, you know?
Yeah.
And the show will live on, but it won't be like this social coup of like, oh man, the Lannisters, well, they always pay their debts, don't they? Like, I'm really excited about all this.
What say you, Andrew?
Yeah, I agree. I think that they'll be continuously popular, but you certainly see how with the Harry Potter series, those books still sell extremely well. But when J.K. Rowling launched Pottermore as the online destination for Harry Potter fans is that the idea that this is going to be a place where all the fans go. You can have this environment. It's going to be this Harry Potter all 24/7. And it was an amazing idea that came 5 years too late.
Yeah.
And that was the only place you could get the ebook versions of them. And that was going to be the exclusive place to do that. Quickly, we saw that started to shift and change. And now you can get, they have amazing digital versions on, you know, the iBooks, the Audible versions. The Audible books are now on Audible and all that because it just was. It was too late. And Harry Potter's still huge and big. It's a very big franchise. And the Harry Potter attractions at Universal Studios in Orlando, colossal, the one they're building here, there's going to be no longer a slow season at the park here because of that. And so it will always be big. But the Harry Potter mania of, you know, unless she does another book, which they've got to be doing a novelization of Fantastic Beasts, and she wrote the screenplay, so we'll see what happens to that. And so I think we might get a bit of that.
Yeah, you know, it would make a lot of
and
sense.
I'm sorry, and The Cursed Child, the London play,
which apparently is like sold out through infinity.
Yeah,
like that's if they bring that, I mean, you got to figure they'll bring it stateside, right? Like it's a gigantic property.
And I just, my comment on that too is they unveiled the cast of it later on, and it a great. Great experienced cast to do that, and they chose a black actress to play Hermione, and J.K. Rowling pointed out, said, hey, I never said she looked white or whatever, which is cool, but it makes Malfoy really a jerk. Wow. For some of his comments that he said.
Yeah, definitely hit the nail on the head with the KKK analogies for the Death Eaters, huh?
Yeah, wow. Blood and all this stuff. Like, wow, this has got even more evil.
That's amazing.
It's cool. And it's cool that, too, it's like, it's neat that I love the fact that she decided to go back and tell stories in that we're getting a prequel and then we're getting a play, that we're getting this sort of thing that she's invested and interested in it, and that she feels comfortable enough to, like, you know what, like, I'm going to play with my literary version of this, and I'm going to give you a literary thing, and I'm going to go against your expectations on that and make that universe bigger and more inclusive, et cetera, which is pretty awesome.
Well, I think we've seen a couple ways that people are, they have guided their massive franchises. And maybe part of it is that, like, you're always going to have a complicated relationship when fandom gets that hardcore, right? Like, there's just always, I mean, these are, again, they're creators, they're imperfect people like we all are that have, flaws and stuff. And oftentimes that gets magnified the hotter the spotlight gets. But no matter what, you're going to have, people that, if it gets to this kind of blockbuster level, you're always going to have some kind of weird relationship with people who love your stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Unless you're like Vince Gilligan, and who's like apparently the nicest person in the world. Everyone just loves no matter what.
Well, that's the same with J.J. Abrams, is that by all accounts, all of our friends who know him, everybody we know who's met him, he's a really nice guy. There's a reason why so many people rooting for him to succeed was because he's become a very successful person, yet by all accounts, just chill. Do you see Larry Fong's photo of J.J. Abrams on Instagram?
Oh, on his Instagram?
This is great. So Larry, who we know, Larry's a magician. He's a cinematographer. He's currently the cinematographer on Batman versus Superman, and he's known Snyder, and it's funny, the first thing that comes up is his thing. Here's a photo of J.J. Abrams in his band.
Yeah!
That's something that Larry took. So apparently, back in the day...
That's amazing.
J.J. Abrams, so the alternate universe where they got that MTV airplay, and he never went on to co-write like Toy Story and Armageddon.
That's great. All right. Picks. Well, I guess I don't know. I love Hateful Eight. Go watch Hateful Eight. It's really great.
Yeah. Watch Rebels. That's my pick. Rebels is good.
I've been catching up on Rebels too, so I'm going to double down on Rebels.
Also, I watched Making a Murderer. It's a thing that'll make you feel some ways.
what was your take?
If there's some attraction to watching a slow motion train wreck, and just realizing, it awoke a lot of feelings that I got from the Wire, where it's like, oh yeah, this is, this engine of the state is just run by a bunch of individual people looking out for number one, and they care about their reputation and their, pension and all that stuff. And, Drop a little bit of evidence over here. It's like, what do these poor people matter? I don't know.
I mean, come on, man. Now, man, could you just drop a little evidence over here now, man? Come on now.
Drop
a little evidence is all I'm asking.
I mean, let me get a little bit of the blood and just go glue, glue, glue.
Luke over there is. He's fine. He'd be all right. You don't belong in the outside world anyway.
Making a murderer. You know, man. I'm just trying to do this old little effort.
Little soft-headed learning disability child. I got him to say the right word, didn't I? You probably was a murderer. Going to be a murderer? Let's put him in the way.
I've already seen the series if that was the lawyer. If that was like the lawyer for whoever is this guy.
Pretty much.
I'm a junior.
There's a little miscarriage of justice.
I'm very curious to see it. I always have very conflicted feelings on documentaries like this.
Well, I'll tell you what. I had very conflicted feelings and continue about the whole Serial phenomenon. Serial really upsets me in that it's just poking fingers around, stirring stuff up, and then shrugging, saying like, man, I don't know, complicated, bye. Off it goes. I respect Making a Murderer much, much more because it is an advocacy. It has a position. It has a take, and it's clearly telling a lopsided story to you have a hero, you have a villain, or at least some kind of complication. I respect it because I think it's much more honest than Serial in its biasness.
in that it is announcing its bias and saying, we believe that this man is innocent and here is our case to show you that.
Correct.
That's the only thing, though, is that I sometimes get a little weird when that's the entertainment. When it's like, because there have been a lot of very famous documentaries. There's been a lot of very famous articles written exonerating people in situations, and I have not seen this. I have no idea how it relates, but upon further review, getting back to peer reviewing, we were talking about during Weird Things, a lot of these cases, when you get into advocacy, you shape your narrative to show what is, most favorable. And in some cases, when you leave stuff out, it's like, well, no, yeah, maybe this guy or these people or this thing, really did happen, or they really did do it. Or like, there's really good reason to believe that this happened. And when you get people so fired up about it and you criticize everybody who is in motion to put, to involved in the case and drag their name through the mud, it's hard. I get a little frustrated by that. It just always, it's not that I think that it shouldn't be there. It's not that I think that it's bad. It just, it always kind of gives me kind of a little bit of a queasy stomach to watch.
Well, I'm going to bet that sooner or later you'll give it a watch. I'd love to hear your opinion coming out the other side.
Oh, definitely. I mean, everybody's talking about it too much for me to watch it. And also, like, I'm on this thing with Ashley. I just got to keep her watching TV because it's like, now that I'm home all the time, it's like, listen, this is the only time I'm going to be able to do it. Like, I just got to get her into the, like, hey, everybody's talking about it. We got to watch it together.
That's curious. What we're doing. I share Justin's frustration. There's been... And often, sometimes too, when things, documentaries are very powerful and potent, and they are the very easiest way to mislead. And there's one that's been very popular lately that flat out contradicts. It's not, many things they said are not true. They assail certain, I don't even want to name it. There's certain people have got a fear that, may have ruined some lives, but because the topic is so hot button and we need to be talking about this. Like, yeah, but this isn't, yeah, but that's not important. It's like, no, when we start saying things aren't, it's the same as in cases where people do drop a little evidence. Like, we know he's guilty. It doesn't matter. And it's like, you can't, both of you don't get to do that. Both sides, it's a lie. It's a lie. It's a lie. There is no such thing as this lie that helps this greater truth, because if you're capable of lying to yourself on a small level and lying to other people to promote your truth, maybe you don't have truth. And I can think of like a couple movies like that. Do you ever see blankety blank about, so, oh yeah, the guy that got free and then started beating up women because he actually was that bad of a guy? And I'm like, oh yeah, never mind. Yeah, sorry.
Yeah, that's,
truth to power. It's been after things.
Yeah. No. This is the story of a tropical storm.
I'm so glad that we both were thinking of the same movie.
Yeah, that dude's a bad dude.
There's plenty of evidence here.
You're just playing a little evidence.
There's a lot of evidence,
Punch people? You think you're punching people's all right? I'm fine. Oh, bust a tail light. Get you over there with a bunch of white jurors.
Oh man. Yeah. All right. I could grab something to eat. All right.
All right.
Everybody. Love you guys. Bye.
Laters.
Bye.